PSA, don't go driving near the Everglades. Written by, I escaped from a lab. My friends and I had developed a love of diving, having grown up in Lake Worth, Florida. Ben was my best friend, and Sadie, his girlfriend, had introduced me to Samantha, the love of my life. Red-haired and vibrant, she was happily obnoxious in a way that I found endearing. We had spent the past 9 years together. I say was because her mother, a vulnerable old hippie, passed away long after a brutal battle with Alzheimer's that had taken its toll on all of us. She had slowly stopped diving, and I with her, as the illness got worse. But Ben and Sadie, our closest friends, brought it up again over beers one Friday night after they had gotten us to promise to go diving with them again. As Sadie brought in some gear and set up her laptop, Ben began to show us some pictures of a mangrove forest that formed a lagoon that they had recently visited while scuba diving solo near the 10,000 islands on the other coast, near Everglades City. It's a massive estuarine mangrove forest. His girlfriend Sadie owned a flatbed boat and a trailer, and it made the hobby relatively easy with all of us sharing the cost. Get ready to crap your pants because the answers to all your problems are in these pictures. Samantha shot me a confused look before resuming staring quizzically at the pictures of a crack in the seafloor. Slowly, the confusion drained from her face. That crack was a river. I could hear the awe in Samantha's voice. In the middle of a large clearing was a meandering crack in the ground. Embedded in the sides of those cracks were obvious tree roots. Cypress knees, a common sight in many parts of Florida, jutted rudely out from the seafloor. An eel darted over the shattered ancient remains of a tree trunk. The small spot that Ben had discovered had covered over an underwater forest. A small patch of ocean floor that was land during the last ice age and still had the wood to prove it. It must have been preserved in sand. It was like meeting the skunk ape while standing in line for a medianoche. There was something about the images that was far more than the sum of their parts. I could practically imagine how I would feel swimming through the water. You could imagine the river running through the crevices in those pictures. Ben flashed his most charming smile. "So, like, how old are these usually?" Ben asked, with hope in his eyes. "We'd need to get some scientists out there to protect it and to find out," Sadie said. "We want you to work with us to make a profit off of it. We could all get rich if we're careful." The phrase, helping them out, had become a frequently used euphemism for helping us with the problem over the past 2 years. Whether it be babysitting Samantha's mom while we went to a movie or to give us work that pays a little. Sadie smiled at Ben admiringly and wrapped herself around his bicep, swiping to the next picture on the display of Ben's underwater camera. I could imagine helping Samantha out was something of Sadie's influence since they grew up together. We all knew that she needed money to pay her still painful student loans that she took out to help her mother. She had worked so hard taking care of her mother that it was all that she knew. And with her gone, there seemed to be nothing left that could spark her interest. Every time a part of her mother's personality evaporated, it was like part of hers went too. When her mother began to no longer smile at the mention of Woodstock, or failed to shake her fist at the obnoxious pickup with smokestacks driving by her window, it broke Samantha in a way that I didn't know it was happening. It was so slowly, and it happened over the years. It left a painful hole in our life where Samantha's smile used to be. But the conclusion seemed inescapable. More and more I was worried about suicide, and they knew it. There was no chance of a girl with a bachelor's degree in healthcare administration paying off $76,000 in student loans and interest, and it's impossible to declare bankruptcy on them. The years of caring for a mother who no longer recognized her had aged her visibly. She always made an effort to be chipper, right up until her mother's death. At her mother's funeral, Samantha had been dead quiet, and she had never really opened up or talked again at all. She had such a wild laugh, and the lack of it was a stunning silence that none of us ever got used to. So, what does this mean? Should we email someone at FAU or something? Samantha asked, watching everyone's reaction closely. We had a slightly more lucrative idea, Sadie said with a cautious smile, taking Samantha's hand. Well, that wood is pretty ancient. We could probably sell some of it for a ton of money. It's cypress, so it might hold up well enough if it was thoroughly submerged, especially if it was only recently uncovered, Ben said, looking at everyone else for approval. I could feel my head nodding rapidly before the profuse thanking began. Samantha looked utterly and purely shocked before finally showing the first sign of a smile that we had seen in months. We all knew what that wood might be worth. We had seen documentaries on other underwater forests. Luxury furniture makers looked for the stuff. Ben seems to think that he has a guy who is perfect for this, Sadie said. It's an old professor of mine. He got fired for some shady stuff, so he would probably know his way around this sort of stuff. That's all I'm saying is that this guy has a record. That means that he thinks outside the box a bit. Ben threw his hands up with this stupid comment, as if whatever he was suggesting was the only obvious choice. I hate to admit this, but you're kind of right, Sadie said hesitantly, wincing slightly. She normally knew better than to get on board with her boyfriend's ideas. Kyle, take a look at this. The screen had two browser windows sharing a space. One was a picture of a smiling man with a bow tie holding up a plaque. It was an award from FAU, the major local university. The other was the mugshot of the same man. Apparently, he had developed a taste for crystal meth and had been caught stealing from the department that he had once been the head of. His background included anthropology and some kind of work in physics that seemed to have something to do with carbon dating. I mean, one way or another, we should look through it, right? I think I want to go, Samantha said. She seemed oddly distant and still very reluctant, as if she wasn't even listening to our conversation and was worried about something else entirely. I'm going to give him a call. At the very least, he might be able to give us advice on what to do with it, Sadie said with a tone of finality. Don't tell him where we picked it up. We don't want to raise any flags, Ben warned her. No one pointed out to poor Ben that this guy would probably be well aware of why we were interested in him. Yeah, we don't want some tweaker stealing the location, Sadie replied with a smile while dialing her cell phone. Don't you get a reward for offering the location to a university too? We could at least look into it. No one had expected that from Samantha, but her voice got weaker as she said it, and she stood with her head down afterwards. Thankfully, no one was able to respond before the man Sadie was trying to reach picked up. Hi, my name is Sadie Marks, and I'm looking for John Hesch. I heard a mumble coming from the speaker that was pressed to Sadie's ear. Great, me and some friends of mine are divers here in Florida, and we found something interesting. We think we found an underwater forest, like the ones they found in Alabama and the Gulf Coast. We wanted to know if you might know how to handle something like this discreetly. Sadie was quiet as the man presumably spoke to her. A moment later, she was beaming at us with a smile. Yes, that would be perfect. And no, we haven't told anyone that we found anything. We figured that it might be jacked by a university, right? We can get a sample easily, and Friday would be great. She ended the call and then put her cell phone into her pants. He knows a guy who would be interested and can handle it. If we're right, the same source had offered $250,000 for the previous location. We can meet him Friday at a lab in Loxahatchee. If the dating goes over well, we're going to drive them out there and they're going to cut us a check. Samantha didn't offer any objections this time. That was way more than a university would be able to offer. They have labs in Loxahatchee? I asked, almost as stunned by this revelation as I was about the value of the coordinates. Loxahatchee is an area just west of Palm Beach, and it had some farms, a lot of swamps, and that was pretty much it.
Oh boy, that's a lot of money, Ben said with a stunned expression on his face, ignoring my question.
The sheer size of the potential amount answered any questions, moral or otherwise. A quick Google search revealed no interest by anyone else in the area for years. Aside from some dude who made fried pork tenderloin sandwiches at the nearest gas station, which was itself reassuringly far away.
So, we're all doing this?
Sadie asked after meandering back into the living room to prepare and pack our bags before going to sleep. It was a ritual that we were all used to, but the added element made it seem strange.
Yes, absolutely. We have to go there,
Samantha stated adamantly. Her gaze was unfocused, and she didn't have a clear expression on her face. Ben took another swipe through his pictures and said,
"We could be rich."
He said it with such a sense of awe that it really expressed what we were all feeling.
Even if we didn't do this, someone else would. It doesn't make sense not to profit from it,
Sadie stated confidently. I didn't say anything, but I went to sleep with the same mix of dread and delight that I had had when I had broken into the teacher's lounge to see if they actually had booze in there when I was in the 9th grade. We spent the rest of the night looking into how to preserve ancient wood for carbon dating, how carbon dating works, and getting the supplies to care for our target sample. Samantha seemed off-kilter from the news and distracted, but she was happy. She asked if someone had called her name twice, once when the house was quiet. Before we went to sleep that night, Samantha and I had some of the best sex of my entire life. As I slept, I dreamed that I was in that ancient riverbed. Except this time, it wasn't just a picture. It wasn't just a few ancient roots and the trunks either. It was an entire dead forest. Even skeletal shrubbery stuck out from the sand. The mangrove wall around them was absolutely massive, with roots like a redwood. I saw the roots spread, gently at first, but then persistently, as if they were alive. The ground broke apart, and the trunks began to grow thicker before my eyes. The wood became richer and fresher. Deep in the strange wall surrounding the riverbed, I saw a massive growth of mangrove roots moving through the cloudy water. But they weren't roots, and they were moving fast. I tried to look closer before suddenly waking up. Samantha was right next to me when I woke up. Our eyes met wide open as we both attempted to adjust to the dark.
Did you see it too?
She asked quietly, and I nodded.
What do you think it was?
I could hear a note of eagerness in her voice, and I didn't understand. It was a freaking nightmare, inspired by some weird pictures, I said. In the dark, I could see her smirk just slightly before she kissed me. I knew then that it couldn't possibly be a coincidence. But, like a health problem that I couldn't afford to treat anyways, I pushed it to the back of my mind and focused on what was dead in front of me. When I woke up the second time, Samantha had already woken up and left the room. It was dead silent at the breakfast table. Aside from Ben giving us the address to where we would launch at in case we got separated on the way, I could tell that something was wrong. But Ben and Sadie made no effort to bring up their dreams, if any. We left quietly. Ben's black 1982 Suburban and my 2009 Yukon were in good enough shape for a little off-roading. We hitched up the boat and headed to a gas station for ice and drinks, as well as garbage food in case the fried tenderloin sandwiches weren't a hit. We couldn't find a Publix anywhere near the launch, and it was too early, so we had to make do. After making sure that everything was prepped, we jumped on the road, heading to the Tamiami Trail and taking that to the optimistically named Everglades City, which is really more like a very large mobile home park that God periodically smites with a hurricane. The Everglades themselves, in case you're unfamiliar with Florida, are a massive, unique wetlands that takes up a large chunk of the state. It's kind of like a huge, slow-moving river. The drive was hellishly long, shifting from South Florida's dense sprawl to the long road that cut its way to the Everglades. The Tamiami Trail is a claustrophobic route, with Florida's natural shrubbery blurring into dense green walls on either side of our SUV caravan for hours. The only people on the road were us and the Florida Fish and Wildlife Patrols with their boats in tow. The thick walls of pine were interspersed with brief glimpses of the incredible wetlands that seemed to threaten to engulf the thin strip of road that had skewered its last surviving corner. We finally came to a crack in the wall of trees where Ben used his arm to indicate that we would be going through. After cringing our way off the road, past the scrape of branch on metal, we realized that the small crack had a thin trail behind it running through the lands that were barely solid enough for our SUVs. I couldn't be certain that Fish and Wildlife weren't already aware of it. In dire contrast to the road, it seemed like the natural world was in constant, ambiguous flux between water and land. We stuck close to Ben in hopes of avoiding the water that lined either side of the small strip of solidish land. And I thanked God that I had all-wheel drive. We launched the large flat-bottomed boat while we nervously looked over the water for any signs of other boats. Normally, we would have had a beer or two by now. But this time, the only drinks were the water and caffeine that we had gotten earlier. The small bay where we launched was lined with mangroves. Their roots held the multitude of small, tiny, sandy islands together. After moving carefully from one end of the island to the other, it became clear that no one would be able to see our SUVs unless they got very close. I prayed that the patrols weren't too attentive that day. "All right, let's head out." Sadie had a firm, reassuring tone that made me feel slightly better about the situation. "It's a small lagoon formed by a tight-knit group of mangrove islands about 35 minutes away, south by southeast." Ben nodded confidently in the direction that we would be heading. "All right, we're going to pick up a few stumps, as much wood that looks and feels as solid as possible without taking too long. None of this stuff is going to last long, one way or the other. We can't waste time, so let's try and get as much high-quality stuff as we can." Sadie analyzed as she spoke. Samantha didn't look happy, but she did look determined. "The main goal is that we need solid samples to prove the location as quickly as possible to sell it to the highest bidder." Sadie posed the statement almost like a question. I felt myself nodding along with everyone else. We navigated between the ever-changing walls of roots and key islands, which made the land seem to be shattered and the water seemed vividly alive. Before we knew it, we had arrived at a strange-looking ring of mangrove tree islands in the water surrounding a vast and deep pool. "Holy," I heard the words just barely escape my lips. It wasn't exactly like my dream. The trees weren't fantastically huge. The forest only had some roots near a fissure, but the general idea was close. I only heard the sound of bags being unzipped and kit being prepared in response. The trees were incredibly densely packed and absurdly thick for mangroves, and their trunks didn't dare escape a tight ring to which they seemed confined. Not a single tree stood out of order, forming a structure that looked as sound as anything civilization could have built. But they were all of normal size, and the seafloor was barren aside from the crack and what looked like a trunk. The Everglades are infamous for a lack of distinction between solid land and water, but this area, closer to the Key Islands than to the land, had gone from being marshy to absurdly deep. It was like a slice of land that had refused to give up its treasure. While I gazed in awe at the trees, I heard a splash. Samantha whispered something in awe as she disappeared behind her diving suit and scuba gear. Sadie followed shortly after her. Ben checked over the winch nervously before getting into his own gear and turning the floodlights on. By the time my goggles were on, I was the only one left on the boat. I braced myself for the shock as I jumped into the water. The pictures didn't come close to doing the place justice.
but I was deeply glad that it was nothing like my dream. The roots of the mangroves were normal, and there was no underwater forest. The light from the floodlights was occluded immediately by the algae and debris in the water. The mangroves surrounding the massive lagoon formed a thick, powerful wall around an enormous basin. As I swam up to my friends, I could make out thick tangles of root systems jutting out from what looked like a massive artery of watery floor, complete with capillaries spreading into the dark. We swam in place, staring at the fissure, when I noticed Samantha below us. Rather than gawk at the spectacle, Samantha had shot ahead of us and seemed to be searching a section of the sunken river. There had clearly once been an entire ecosystem here, its tributaries rendered irrelevant by the water, its vegetation unable to flourish. We had assumed that it had been uncovered from the sediment at the bottom of the floor, like the other underwater forest. But I could now see that there were no signs of any upheaval. The ground was as smooth as marble. This was a chunk of the old world, preserved for thousands of years. But how? As I stared in awe at the incredible sight ahead of me, Ben and Sadie were sizing up a particularly large tree stump about 30 feet below me, when Ben put in the first spike. The sound of wood cracking traveled through the water and was physically palatable throughout my body. Ben waved to me and pointed to the other side of the trunk that he was working spikes into. I swam down to him and grabbed a spike. The wood gave some resistance, which was far more than I expected. I felt the shock waves of the spike going through the core as Ben and Sadie worked to get the roots clear of the thick mass that they had become tangled in. Even the smaller bits of wood refused to disintegrate. But we got the final spike in and attached them to the ropes that were in turn connected to the cable running to the winch on the boat. Ben swam up, presumably to turn it on. I noticed that Samantha was pawing through the dirt behind us, but I couldn't see what she was pulling at. As the thing finally gave way and began to rise with the pull of the winch, I saw something moving behind the mangroves. It made my heart jump. At first, I thought it was a massive fish or something. But when I looked closely, it just looked like more mangrove roots swaying. I noticed then that Samantha was excitedly tugging at something, and I went to go investigate her find as well as to tell her it was time to scram. It looked like she was trying to get another piece of wood out of the muck, but when I noticed something shiny, I went to get a closer look. It suddenly came free, causing a rush of debris. It looked like whatever it was had been wedged into a tree trunk or something under the water. Samantha waved away the debris, allowing me to see something. It was a mask. Samantha was bent over with it in awe and shock. Her entire tiny body moved with every attempt to clean the thing. It was hard to see the mask past her frenzied labor, but there was no mistaking the two strangely shaped eyes, nose, and mouth holes. I could see Sadie stop moving as she focused on the thing. Buried under several feet of sand and dirt, unless we were wrong, this place had not been touched by human hands. It had to be truly ancient. As Samantha swam to the surface with her incredible find, Sadie began to dig rapidly in the same area. We were underwater, so it was impossible to tell her that she might destroy other artifacts. But she seemed to realize her error when I tapped her on the shoulder and pointed to the boat above us. As we swam to the surface, Sadie suddenly stopped and stared off into the distance. I saw only mangroves where she was looking, but as I turned around to go back up to the boat, I saw it. Mangroves, except they were moving. More than that, they were swimming. I sank slightly as my limbs stiffened from shock before resuming rapidly. Winding through the water away from us, I saw a massive thicket of mangroves swaying gracefully in the same way a fish's tail would, just for a moment before it disappeared into the murk. Sadie spun around before realizing that I was above her and began to swim desperately upwards. When I got to the surface, Samantha was already cleaning the mask gently. An archaeologist would probably be upset to see someone pouring bottled water over something that old, much less her gentle use of a Q-tip to dry it.
She showed it to me with a look of awe on her face for expression. It was split in half, with one half looking like a badly weathered swamp monster, and the other having an array of uncomfortably asymmetrical blue bumps over a stunningly clear beige. The mask was some kind of ceramic, or else the wood was simply very hard. I could feel my heart sink as I realized that this thing didn't look like it was very old at all. On closer inspection, the uglier side seemed to be composed of notches that formed a scale-like texture, but it felt like it was made from the same material as the beautiful side.
"We're all going to be rich,"
Sadie said nonchalantly, like it was the time of day.
"Do you guys think this is really as old as we thought this place was?"
Samantha said with caution in her voice.
"I mean, it's possible. We're going to have to bring the trunk or something for a verification. We can look into it then."
Ben sounded hopeful, almost reverent. It doesn't seem likely. If it were, the mask would be really ancient. It might just be a plot of land that fell into a sinkhole. If not, though, this could really do it for us, I heard myself saying. Even as I said it, the memory of the wall of mangrove roots surfaced in my head. I could almost see it again. No sinkhole did that.
"All right, so it doesn't sound like there are any conscientious objectors. Anyone happen to know someone with a background in, well, whatever this is?"
Sadie said as she held up the mask to us, and we all giggled. Sadie and Ben prepared the trunk. Then Sadie placed in a vacuum-packed bag with a lot of rice separated by a filter, and then we gently placed the thing in a cooler, which we all knew not to open.
"I hope the damage isn't too severe, but it should be enough to prove the location as it is."
Sadie clapped her hands together with a satisfied expression. She then gave Samantha a concerned expression, and I know the control freak in her wanted to take care of the mask for Samantha, but she seemed to be biting her tongue. We packed everything up and headed back the way we had come. We had to drive in reverse for a bit, but we managed to get through it. We picked up some sandwiches, and sure enough, pork tenderloin when pounded flat and marinated in mojo sauce, battered and fried, served on a bun with pickles and mustard, is delicious. This led to Ben speculating about how insanely cheap pork tenderloin is at Costco, and then wondering how many sandwiches he could make for $30. I don't really know why he was suddenly focusing on saving money, but the sandwich was so epic that I didn't interrupt him. That night, Samantha and I had sex again. The moment my eyes shut from the post-coital bliss, I was underwater again. The mangroves, unnaturally thick and cord-like, reminding me of redwoods. The fissure in the ground was there, but like the previous dream, it was not barren. The skeletons of strange shrubs and the husk of cypress trees stuck out of the ground. Even more incredible, there was a fleck of green. I looked closer, and sure enough, the shrubs still had some leaves. Strange, prehistoric magenta and green leaves. As I stared at the vegetation before me, it seemed to grow, to become more vivid. I began to swim towards the surface, but as I did, I saw a massive trail of mangrove roots swirl from behind me, and I felt the water move strangely. Before I could turn around, my eyes shot open. When I woke up to go to the bathroom, Samantha wasn't in bed. I saw her in the living room, hunched over the table. Her entire body was still. I think that I told myself something along the lines of it being a good thing that she was so interested in the mask. I couldn't let go of this. That money could save her life. I told myself that she would get better soon, and I decided not to bother her and went back to sleep. As I went to sleep, I pretended that the mountain of blankets beside me was her, and that she was happy again. When I woke up, everyone but Sadie was awake. Samantha was cleaning the kitchen with a weird enthusiasm, and it looked as if she had drunk a pot of coffee. Ben was prepping the trunk with a massive grin on his face.
You ready for the big day, dude?
He asked, the grin splitting into an open-mouthed smile. I couldn't help but share his enthusiasm. All of the weight from Samantha's loss and her hellish situation, all of the stress from the bills was going to disappear. I found myself meeting his double high five before turning around to see Samantha preparing her own bag. The mask was no longer on the table.
Are you bringing the mask? I asked, not knowing if that was her plan.
No, no, I don't even know this guy, Samantha answered sheepishly, as if the answer was embarrassingly personal for her.
Cool, cool, all right. Well, we'll bring the trunks, though.
Cool, cool, all right. Well, we can bring them the trunks, though, and then we can find out how much it's worth. Maybe we can just bring them a couple of truckloads of wood and give the location to a university or something, Ben offered in an inspired gesture.
Samantha reacted well, smiling slightly and nodding enthusiastically. I didn't bother to ask her where the mask was because I didn't know if she was acting weirdly because of her own issues, or because she was genuinely worried about protecting the other potential artifacts that were submerged.
Man, does anyone else feel like this is the morning of a big job interview or something?
Sadie asked, wiping the sleep from her eyes as she strode from her bedroom to Ben for a kiss.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to today, Samantha chirped happily.
The butterflies in our stomach didn't stop any of us from eating, especially Samantha, who ate an entire stack of pancakes. We left and drove separately out west through more endless green marshes, this time to Lakahachi, to a massive blue metal prefabricated building on a small road off of the main highway, which had several pickup trucks parked outside. We hooked the boat up to our SUV, knowing that we would likely need to show them the location. A fat man with a yellow hard hat and a vest was waiting outside, and although the years had not been kind, it was clearly Dr. John Hesch. Sadie practically jumped out of her SUV and confidently walked up to the ham-like man, while the rest of us sulked back a little like nervous teenagers.
Good morning, y'all. John Hesch. Pleasure to meet you.
The man happily waddled up to us. He was massive, and his waddle looked like it had been wearing on his knees for the past few years. Sadie shot forward to meet his hand and shake it gregariously. His smile was a massive thing, forcing the fat up his face and turning his eyes briefly into slits.
Good morning, my name is Sadie. As I said on the phone, we have a find here today.
She gestured to the SUV where Ben was now getting the trunk ready. I went to help him and noticed that Samantha was hanging back from us. She was staring at the ground and she looked ill. As Ben and I worked the trunk out of the back of the SUV and onto our dolly, she seemed to shrink back even further. Sadie and Dr. Hesch chatted brightly about scuba diving as we moved the trunk into the metal building, which smelled like a Pep Boys staffed entirely by unwashed testicles. One of the testicles in question, a pale little man with stringy black hair and greasy skin, anxiously motioned for us to move the trunk into a room filled to the brim with shelves covered in what could have been old medical or scientific equipment. Most of it was a similar shade of beige or black. Another man was standing at a table in the back, which we pushed the trunk to. Ben and I nodded to the two men, who nodded back and then went to work putting the trunk on the table. They began scraping and hacking off pieces respectively.
If this thing is the right age, it sure is holding up well, one of them remarked.
I was sure that anything important would get relayed back to me later, and I was worried about Samantha, so I just left. When I got outside, I found out that I was right to be. She was vomiting behind the SUV. Baby, are you all right? I asked stupidly. She turned slowly to face me, wiping the sick from her pretty face. The bags under her eyes were worse, substantially, and the vomit was very dark.
I'm all right, honey, really.
Despite how bad it looked, she sounded happy, oddly relieved, as if the vomit was somehow a good thing.
She sat down next to the SUV on the asphalt and stared off into the distance with a slight smile on her face. They should be out soon. I didn't have enough time to ask her how she knew before Sadie appeared and began to walk towards us. She was weeping. Her mascara was running down her face. I trotted up to her while Samantha continued to sit and gaze into the distance. Did it turn out to be fake? I asked, my heart sinking into my stomach. She shook her head violently. They pulled a gun on us. They said it was legit. They said if we didn't take them to the location, they were going to kill Ben. But that we just had to drive there and leave, and Ben would be released. They're just going to claim that they discovered it first. As long as we let them do that, Ben will be okay. My heart sank much further and much faster. I gawked in disbelief. I looked back at Dr. Hesh, who was exiting the building. His jovial smile was gone, replaced with a face that was 100% business. He crossed his arms and nodded to me solemnly as Sadie collapsed into my arms. I nodded back while moving her slowly into the SUV. She objected and pushed me away.
No, no, I don't trust them.
Just take Dr. Hesh. I'm going to wait for him here. When they let him go, we're going to get out of here. I already warned him that people know that we're here and my cell phone will show us getting here. But he said as long as you lead him there, he'll let Ben go. She wiped away her tears before walking out onto the road and sitting down, facing the building and weeping silently. Samantha tugged at my arm and nodded. She had a strangely peaceful smile on her face. We got into our own SUV and began to pull out of the parking lot, still unsure, as it didn't really feel real. The fat man and his two buddies followed behind in a beaten-up old Silverado with a nice-looking flatbed behind it. Sadie sat cross-leggedly next to her SUV, watching us mournfully before returning her attentions to the metal building. It's gonna be okay. Samantha had a dreamlike tone in her voice as she reached across the center console to squeeze my hand. She smiled softly, and I wondered why she wasn't furious. Sure, it wasn't likely that they would kill us, not with Sadie being able to tell a million people who she was with. They only wanted the wood. But this was her only way to a better life. I couldn't tolerate music playing during the drive, and I was partially glad that Samantha was silent. The pit in my stomach had turned into a dancing flame that gave me so much energy that it was difficult not to jump out of the SUV and go running through the fields. For hours, there was nothing but the hum of my wheels and the sight of palm trees and sand pines to look at, to avoid looking at the ham-faced clown in my rearview mirror. I took a small amount of delight in the look of worry on his face when we finally turned off the road, and I heard wood on metal behind me. Once we finally reached the clearing, Samantha reached over and squeezed my hand. It's going to be okay. Just take them there. She smiled at me again before getting out of the SUV, forcing me to follow. We launched the boat quietly, and I would have preferred for her to wait in the car, but she rejected the idea with a simple shake of her head.
All right, once we get to the spot, you show it to us and I'm gonna signal my man and you can scram, the fat man said.
I didn't respond, I just launched the boat and headed off to the spot, hoping that he died of a coronary before we got there. Him and his greasy friend followed behind us quietly as we made our way to the circle of mangroves. They seemed to be in awe, as they should have been once they saw it.
How is that possible? I heard him ask with no answer.
Samantha began to put on her gear and I followed suit, not planning on sticking around once he had seen the spot. We dove in and felt the two diving splashes of the fat man and one of his friends. This time, however, something was horribly wrong. There weren't just a few stumps down there. It was an entire alien forest, just like my dreams. Most of it was dead, but life glinted like jewels from impossibly shaped leaves. I stared in shock as the fat man and his friend swam past me with a line that went right up to the boat. After staring themselves, the fat man gave me and Samantha a wave and a thumbs up, and then he pulled vigorously on the line. I began to swim back immediately, but as they got closer to the fissure, Samantha began to swim towards them. I was swimming after her as hard as I could when I saw it. Behind the fat man and his friend was a massive swath of mangrove roots beyond the wall. They were moving rapidly towards us, and there seemed to be a person moving with that mangrove tail, their mouths wide open as they screamed underwater, propelled forward as if the roots were a massive fish's tail. I swam harder, hoping to reach Samantha when I noticed her breathing apparatus floating upwards. She had taken off her breather and placed the mask on her face and was now swimming faster towards the fat man, who had taken to trying to get a sizable trunk of cypress broken free from the fissure. I watched as the person swam past the wall of mangroves, and I saw then that it was not a person at all. It was a woman's torso, but the skin was gray and she had no hair. Rather than legs, the thing had a massive tail of root-like tentacles, like a mermaid. It weaved and whipped rapidly through the mangrove roots, sometimes pushing the water like a tail, sometimes grabbing and swinging through the roots like a thousand graceful monkey's tails. Its human-like hands were outstretched and its mouth was open. Before I could get close to Samantha, it had breached the wall and was on the fat man. I could see that the thing's mouth was perfectly round and filled with rings of teeth, like a lamprey. His friend began to swim away when the massive roots began approaching them, but the fat man didn't even get time to turn around. Before he even saw the thing, it swam gracefully up behind him and moved its arms around his waist, pressing its mouth against his back. Scarlet flooded the water, and he began to thrash violently, but then he went still after only a moment. When the thing seemed finished, it dropped him and swam towards his henchmen, who had not yet made it to the boat. The fat man's corpse was little more than an empty bag of skin. I began to swim to the boat, but before I did, I looked down and I saw Samantha staring at me. She was perfectly still in the center of the river, the strange mask covering her face. She blew me a kiss before I saw a plume of red spread through the water where the henchman was. I made it to the boat, and I desperately gasped for air as I pulled myself out of the water. "Everything cool?" the henchman left waiting on the boat stupidly asked. "Yeah, you call them," I shot back as I threw my gear on the deck. "Yeah, hey, where did..." I didn't wait for him to finish the sentence before firing up and hauling out of there. A moment later, I heard a scream as the other flatboat capsized without warning. I was shaking as I hooked my boat to the SUV. I checked my phone, and Sadie had sent me a message saying that Ben had been set free with a warning not to say anything to anyone, because no one would believe him over a bona fide professor. I sped the entire way home, where I told them what I had seen. Ben was shocked and didn't believe me at first, but Sadie had seen something in a nightmare, and slowly she began to believe me. We didn't know what it meant or what to do next, but Sadie suggested filing a missing persons report for Samantha as soon as possible to avoid any suspicion, and that they would help cover for me. Ben bit his lip, and we went to sleep. That night, I dreamed of the underwater forest one last time. This time, it was filled with life. Plants that I had never seen before blossomed and bore fruit that was eaten by strange insects with incredible colors. Leaves regrew flesh and turned green before my eyes as a massive swath of roots gently snaked by the river. The thing leading the roots turned and twisted happily in the water. It was Samantha. She had finally escaped it all.